I was really pleased to, and flattered, I think, to be invited to talk here about Kōdō Sawaki's commentary on the Song of Awakening, this translation of his work on a very famous poem. But before I start the Dharma talk per se, I think I really need to thank you for inviting me. And it's exciting to be in a practice place that I feel a real affinity for. I've been here a few times for Genzo-e, and what you are doing here as your the nature of your practice is really important and quite wonderful. So I also am delighted because this practice place is the home of Kōdō Sawaki's Dharma grandson, Shōdōka Okamura. And I think I need to thank this Dharma grandson for really assisting with this translation by checking my feeble English against the original Japanese. So I have some confidence that it's pretty close to the original. But as I worked to bring the text from French into English, I was a bit apprehensive about the validity of the translation. So Okamura Roshi's work really helped me feel okay about it, if you will, that it was going to transmit something. It's difficult about translation, but when we think about it, from the very beginning, we have received the Dharma through translation. Sanskrit, Pali to palm leaf texts, Sanskrit to Chinese, Chinese to Japanese, and in this case, Japanese to French, and French to English. So we do the best we can to find the core understanding of what the meaning is, and we hope for the best. We have to apply our own thoughts to it. I was comforted in this respect by the words of Sawaki Roshi himself. I'm going to quote, "What we call the way is the imprint of the footsteps of the sages of the past. That is to say, the traces sages have left on the road they have taken. To take this way is to make it one's own and make it one's own lifeline. To put it another way, in realizing our true nature, we ourselves become the way, each one all the while walking it in his own manner. We must find our own way, not as an imitation." But when I first considered, having accepted the invitation, I was really taken aback because now I had to figure out what to do about a book that's over 400 pages long, because the charge was, well, come speak about the book. Oh. It seemed impossible. And I feel, as you go through it, there's a topic for a Dharma talk on nearly every page. So what was I going to do? Added to this, what Sawaki Roshi is commenting on is Shōdōka, or what we call the Song of Awakening, by Yongjia Xuanjue, a 7th century Chinese Chan master, and it itself is an integral text in our tradition. So now we've got a mass of material here that I was trying to think how I would sort through. And I should add here, just because it may come up when I quote from the text, that the Chinese Chan master was known in Japanese as Yoka Genkaku, and to Sawaki Roshi as Yoka Daishi. It was a form of honor and endearment, if you will. And he's a poet, and he's written a very long, very beautiful, complex, and personal Song of Enlightenment. This is how he tries to explain to us how he came to understand more fully. So what was I going to do? I could choose a paragraph, make it a subject. Which one? There's an awful lot in this book, which is derived from recordings made of lectures he gave at Komazawa University. And I should add in that respect that something I love about this book is that it wasn't written, rewritten, edited, toned down, so we had only the nice stuff. Very often when we look at our ancient masters, we have no idea who they were. We only know that they were brilliant, they were awakened, and they said wonderful things. We don't know how they treated their students, whether they ate too much, drank too much. We know nothing about them. But in Sawaki here is really here as a very human being, because they just recorded the lectures and they were transcribed. And he was a, I think, terrifying lecturer to his students at Komazawa. And I sometimes have, as I read through this book, a feeling that he was using his commentary on the Song of Awakening as a sort of platform to force-feed his students everything they ever needed to know about Buddhism. And I found as I went through it that he is feeding me endless insights, endless material, and it usually has to do with the verse he's commenting on, but not always. He would digress. But it's a very complete picture of how he views practice. But ultimately, you know, I paged through this book and I decided that I would try to talk about what I perceive, this is really my personal perception, of his view of the usual human being like us, and his insistence that this person must go beyond his usual life and become his true self. Sawaki Roshi then offers his perspective on how this can happen, a perspective that may seem a bit surprising, since it does not involve striving to accomplish a specific program in the practice. If any of you know the Avatamsaka Sutra, there were endless stages the bodhisattvas worked through, eon after eon after eon. None of that. Nor is it about a required number of hours of zazen, despite the fact that for him, zazen is the central practice. And he was devoted to it and very fierce in positing it as the one true practice. However, my feeling as I read through this book, instead, he's seeming to suggest that our basic problem lies in how we view life, stuck as we are in our own illusions. There are many other threads of meaning, and it's a big book, but this is the one I'm hoping to follow with you this morning. I'll be doing a great deal of quoting from the book, so hopefully you get a little taste of him. Sawaki Roshi sees us as frozen, stuck, in what he calls the world below zero. Now, when he speaks of zero here, he is speaking of 0 degrees centigrade, or 32 degrees Fahrenheit, the point at which water freezes from being fluid to being ice. He says, and I quote, "When I recently traveled to Manchuria, I coined a phrase suitable to Manchuria, below zero centigrade, or the freezing point. It became pretty popular. It's also apparent that the world of zero isn't limited to Manchuria. Within the world below zero, we find innumerable specimens, the rich, the powerful, leading figures in the university or in society. Man must absolutely pass beyond this world of zero." So what is this world of zero in which he says most of us exist? I feel that it is the ice of our illusions and our desires, the frozen expanse of our misunderstandings in which we are trapped. The open water of the world into which we were born has gradually frozen into rigid delusions about how things actually are. Little by little, our opinions, our ideas, our viewpoint, they've congealed until we are trapped within them. Our frozen world, I might add, is also one that fiercely rejects any possibility of a thaw that might be produced by the blazing sun of a wider vision of the universe. In short, we resist change, even if we are frozen in pain. Even with our devotion to Zen practice, we may be frozen within illusions about its nature. We must take care. And it is important to realize that our rigid and frozen understandings can impede the freely flowing river of impermanence. We get in the way. We get in our own way. We wish to grasp things and situations by knowing. I know all about that. Been there, done that. We try to freeze them into something solid that we can control, either literally or mentally. And I don't know about you, but I'm always uneasy when someone says, "Oh, I've heard all about you." They're trying to freeze me into their image of me. And sometimes I think we can know too much. Free-flowing reality being held back behind a self-constructed dam of our own assumptions. If we know how it is, we're obstructing other understandings. We've raised a dam. Dogen Zenji refers to this in one of the evening Dharma discourses that he gave to his monks. Now, this is taken from the Leighton and Okamura translation of the Ehe Koroku. It's Dharma Hall Discourse 447. I'd like to share with you Dogen's statement at the end of the discourse. The discourse was on the topic of knowing or not knowing. And his statement is actually one of my very favorites. It always amuses me and helps me. After a pause, Dogen said, "If the great ocean knew it was full, the hundreds of rivers would all flow upstream. The great ocean would slam shut its gates to the rivers of the world if it thought, if it knew that there was no room. Fortunately for our world, the ocean does not know, does not think of empty or full, and generously receives all the rivers that flow into it." But I've always loved this. If the great ocean knew it was full, thought it was full, all the rivers would be sent back home. "No more, I can't take you." But it isn't just this way, I feel, trapped in our frozen concepts, that we in the world below zero shut ourselves off from possibilities, seeing only the world distorted and restricted, hemmed in by our illusions. And since I've just used the word possibilities, I'm going to interject here an idea of my own concerning an additional metaphor we might use when we think of the world below zero. Within our concept of mathematics, zero marks the dividing line between plus and minus. The world below zero is the minus world, the world in which we are hemmed in by what cannot be done, by a very narrow range of possibilities. When we leap over zero, we enter the plus world, a world full of a vast range of possibilities. So whether we live in a world of frozen concepts or a world lacking possibility, we must find a way to leap beyond zero. Kōdō Sawaki insists, he absolutely insists, that we free ourselves, that we leap free of the ice of our illusions so that the rivers will flow into the ocean. He says, in these excerpted statements, which I have chosen to link together, I've taken them from the book, I'm going to quote him. Sawaki Roshi said, "We must leap over the barrier of zero. That which is beyond zero has no name. It is the truth. This thing without name that we call true reality must be sought after. Everything found below zero is in the realm of the dream. We have also seen that to cut through the illusions of the world is to seize the root. To put it another way, the man who turned in a circle without ever getting anywhere now points himself in the right direction. The ultimate end of Buddha's teaching is to make men leap over the barrier of zero were it only once. This is truly the great business of Buddhism. When we go beyond zero, there is no delusion to avoid and no satori, awakening, to seek after. When a person goes beyond zero, he is great, even if a janitor. This is what, quote, the self is itself Buddha, Sokushin Sobutsu, means. Then all things are equal. For me, a key phrase in this, important to think about, is, quote, then all things are equal. And I'd like to talk about that for just a moment. Within our everyday understanding, all things are not equal. They differ in size, shape, purpose, mode of being, value to us. But once we rise above zero, we understand that all things have equal weight within emptiness. That is to say, all are components of the continual interaction of impermanence and interdependence that creates ever-changing life. All are necessary to life, big or small, known or unknown. This emptiness is Buddha nature. All things are impermanent, are dependent upon one another, and in this sense are equal participants in the endless process. I feel that although we live day to day in a world of dualism, in which we perceive things as separate and distinct, our understanding of their ultimate equality within the process of emptiness may help us to be more flexible in our responses and judgment. It helps pry us loose a little bit to realize that although that guy has a PhD and I don't even have a high school degree, ultimately we're all participants in the universe. We're necessary to it, and therefore we are equal. It helps change our attitudes toward one another. We live, however, in a world of dualism. It's necessary to us. In Busho, Buddha Nature, as translated by Abe and Waddell, Dogen says, quote, the roots, stem, branches, twigs, and leaves are each equally the Buddha nature, living the same life and dying the same death as the entire being. Sawaki echoes this, quote, when we comprehend the essence of the universe, we understand that living beings, plants, minerals, absolutely everything in the universe has Buddha nature, and it's good thus. It is this understanding, this Buddha Dharma, that Sawaki Roshi sees as available to us if we can go beyond zero, and he urges us to do so. And I'm going to quote again. The Buddha Dharma is the sphere of the absolute highest degree. Dim and dense minds situated below zero are blind to the Buddha and the Dharma. If they were to glimpse it, even only for a moment, they would be astonished at having lived up until then at 10,000 degrees below zero. And they'd say to themselves, how have I been able to not only pass through zero, but go beyond? For with a leap, in an instant, they find themselves at the absolute highest degree. Certainly, it is difficult. One can do nothing about that. I can imagine all of his students getting ready to, and he's, you can't do anything about it. Oh. One can do nothing about it. It's the principle of the Buddha Dharma, which I think says we make effort. We try to walk the way. We don't wait for it to descend upon us. And we're also making our way, making the path as we go, relying on, but beyond all of the instructions we've had from teachers, masters, our own study, even our own perceptions in Zazen. but we're explorers and we keep going. This, I think, you know, he says it's the principle of the Buddha Dharma, because the Buddha Dharma says you must do it yourself. The Buddha said that. I can't do it for you. I can't bless you, save you, make you wonderful. I can offer suggestions. I can offer help. I can describe what I've been through. And that's what every teacher, I think, tries to do. But we have to do it ourselves. So it is difficult because we're working with ourselves. He goes on to say, he says, one can do nothing about that. It's the principle of the Buddha Dharma. The Buddha Dharma is the doctrine without fear that the lion roars, and each one of the words has authority. The lion roars. There's courage here. The Buddha Dharma is a doctrine without fear, because it tells us there's nothing to attain. So why be afraid of failing? There is no success. If there's no success, there's no failure. And it also suggests that without fear is how we move forward. Fear, for me in any case, means I'm somehow circling within myself. I am afraid. I'm holding in. I'm going backwards. But to step forward, I have to let go of this little whirlpool of fear that I'm in, and somehow manage to believe that that step forward will be helpful, to find something to do, anything, but to do it. I know there was a time in my life when I actually suffered, I don't think from clinical depression, but I had a very difficult personal circumstance, and I was truly depressed. And I found I made lists. And they included things like, do the dishes, because I knew I would do that. And then I could cross it off and feel I had done something. I've never descended to get out of bed, but I suppose that day may come. But the point is to, you know, simply somehow recognize that you have some forward motion so that you can move out of it. Anyway, you know, he's suggesting that we leap over zero. And it all sounds very well. But the question for me is, what is this leap? What is this going beyond in an instant? As Zen practitioners, we are well aware that our practice of Zazen opens up a remarkable path to recognizing our illusions and letting them go. In Zazen, we get a taste of how it is to be freed from our thoughts. Though they crowd in, we do not have to pay attention to them. We don't try to get rid of them, but we can actually ignore them. They're just thoughts. Yet all too often, as soon as we rise from Zazen, we are once again the prisoner of our dualistic viewpoint, endlessly sorting what we like and what we dislike. So how can we cast off our illusions and awaken to the world beyond zero? Big question. Sawaki Roshi reminds us that we can only reach awakening through seeing our illusions clearly and coming to understand their nature. He said, and I quote, "Illusion and awakening do not have different natures. We must grasp the origin of that which so completely blinds ourselves that we see dualism where none exists," end quote. I want to comment briefly, interject here. I submit that the origin of our, he says, we must grasp the origin of that which so completely blinds ourselves, and we see dualism where none exists. At the same time, I would submit that the origin of our dualism lies in a talent necessary for our life, an ability to discriminate, to isolate, to categorize, that allows us to organize our reality and function in it. Otherwise, it's chaos. So it's how we function in our everyday lives, and we always will. At the same time, this very gift also blocks our glimpse of a world without dualism, in which all things exist as equal in value, in which no judgments exist. Of course, we make a perilous mistake if we attempt to eliminate our dualistic consciousness, for it is our defense against chaos. At the same time, it is this consciousness that is, can be, I will say can be, not is, can be a cold current that continually attempts to freeze everything into a permanently recognizable state. So I know where I am, we say. I need to know where I am. And which thus can create a rigid and inflexible self unable to break through the ice of the world below zero. And of course, we may be quite comfortable in our world below zero, fearing the breakup of the illusory solidity of our attainments, of what we know. I think it is this point to, it's useful at this point to remember the Heart Sutra. The Hanya Shingyo, which tells us there is nothing to attain, and with nothing to attain, the mind is no hindrance. Without hindrance, no fears exist. So, having said this, let me go back to Sawaki Roshi again, having asserted my little thinking about duality. He says, we must become conscious within our most profound depths that our body, as it is one with our mind, and that it is identical with the essence of the universe. To discover the ultimate reality that constitutes the grandeur of our life and consecrate all our efforts to it, we must find it within the nature of our ignorance and our empty and illusory body. We find it here. We find it here. We begin to understand our true relationship to everything else, little by little. He is suggesting that we must have courage and conduct our search for true reality within our own delusions. We see them, when we can see them for what they are, we begin to awaken to a vivid universe beyond comparisons and judgments, beyond dualism. We are urged to expand our vision, to make it as wide as the universe. No, not this. Take the blinders off. Sawaki continues, the aim of the practice of Buddhism is to make us discover true reality. It immediately awakens a pressing need to know what it's like. Now, he says, the true character of reality has but one characteristic, an absence of character. It's neither this nor that. All existence in the universe, all phenomena without exception, are the true nature of reality. There's nothing behind the curtain. It's all true reality. He goes on, it is said in the Hanya Shingyo, all dharmas are marked by emptiness. They neither arise nor cease, are neither defiled nor pure, neither increase nor decrease. Such is the true nature of reality. Without beauty, without filth, without birth, without death. And he continues, we must then comprehend true reality. Still, it's not an easy task, since the human condition is opposed to it. Here, all is illusion. In everything in the world, nothing exists besides illusions. This is why it's difficult for us to understand. To discover the nature of reality is to embrace the panorama of the universe in a single glance. Seems impossible, doesn't it? He says this again and again. Embrace the universe in a single glance. And he goes on, when we have vision like this, we have comprehended the teaching of the Buddha. It's not necessary to use a telescope or bend over a microscope to contemplate the spectacle of the universe. There's no need to take so much trouble, he says. It's sufficient to refuse to perceive all the illusions that blind us, to perceive what we usually see. I'm interjecting here. He goes on, when we have, what we do not embrace the universe within a single glance, and so we weep and we laugh. When our vision is total, there's neither attraction nor repulsion. Things are simply what they are. That's all. This is only this. That is only that. So he's urging us to open wide our eyes, to look beyond the prison walls of self, to see the vast, almost incomprehensible nature of true reality. He said somewhere else, it might be in this book, but something I've always remembered is he said, you know, we're always talking about reality being incomprehensible, immeasurable, incommensurable, all these words that mean, he said, and so we think, what? He said, perhaps the problem is it's everything, and we can't see everything. So this is what he's saying here in a way. It's sufficient to refuse to perceive all the illusions that blind us. Open our eyes. That's why it's called the Song of Awakening. Let me repeat myself here a little bit. Of course, I wouldn't admit I'd lost my place. We're urged to open wide our eyes, to look beyond the prison walls of self, to see the vast, almost incomprehensible nature of true reality. Quote, to embrace the universe with a single glance, end quote. And notice that we are not merely to observe the universe, but to embrace it. This embrace, this wide open embrace, is the leap beyond zero, out into the fluid, moving, changing universe. A universe we can enter without fear, because we too participate. We're already in it. We're not leaving ourselves. We're entering the true nature of our existence. It's a matter of going onward in the realization that it is the activity, the energy of today that creates tomorrow. And the nature of that tomorrow depends upon the fullness with which we have participated in today. It's not just that, you know, today is Sunday and tomorrow is Monday. But the nature of Monday depends on how fully we live Sunday, because it changes. If we just ignore today, perhaps we'll ignore tomorrow. Or we won't have seen something that happened today that I can carry forward into my life tomorrow. So it depends on the fullness of our participation. And here's Dogen again. In Dharma Hall Discourse 34, he says, if this greatest cold does not penetrate into our bones, how will the fragrance of the plum blossoms pervade the entire universe? If this greatest cold does not penetrate into our bones, if we do not fully experience it, how will the fragrance of the plum blossoms pervade the entire universe? It is our full participation in winter that brings spring. Because winter is fully what it is. But for us to fully understand it and experience spring fully as it comes, we can't ignore it. Last week we had over a foot, I think it was 14 inches, of snow in Milwaukee. Yet it is the March storms that herald the thaws and greening of spring, a time for emerging from our shelters and opening our eyes to the renewal of the earth. And I'd like to close this time not with more commentary by Sawaki. But with the next to last line of the Song of Awakening by Yokodaishi. Because I think this says it all. Here's the line. Do not calculate the vastness of the sky by peering at it through a straw. Thank you for listening. So we're open for whatever. Any thoughts people have? Yes.
First of all, I want to say thank you for coming to London and yesterday you gave a workshop. Mm-hmm. Today you gave this wonderful Dharma talk. I really appreciate your kindness. And also, I'd like to say thank you for translating that book from your seat.
Yeah.
2015 was 50th anniversary of Saki Yoshi's death.
Yeah.
And for an anniversary, I made a book of the teaching of homeless Kōdō. Mm-hmm. And your book
and
was
this
published
out,
in the same year.
Yeah.
I think Saki Yoshi's book should be more available in English.
I think so too.
But I cannot translate his Japanese into English.
His Japanese is very difficult. In a way, the true heroine in this is Jeanine Coursin, who struggled to bring it from Japanese into French and did really a remarkable job in many, many ways. So, and had the courage to just do it. It's because his Japanese is very colloquial. And he was lecturing, he was talking. And if, for instance, if we go back and I hear this or I see it written out, what I've said today, it's all broken up into phrases. It's not, you know, in nice, neat sentences, even though I've read a lot of it. I force myself to write things out to keep myself on topic, but also because I'm afraid I would just, you know, it would become incomprehensible, not maybe to the people that hear it, because that's how we speak, but after that. So his work is very difficult to deal with. But I think, if I may say, I think he's enormously important because he really championed a vision of Buddhist study and Zen in Japan that was strong, vivid, accessible. He didn't have a temple. And they, as Shōdōka mentioned, they called him Homeless Kōdō because he traveled around and his sesshin were given in homes, in prisons, at schools, you know, anywhere there was a room. And it took the tradition forward out of an increasingly, I feel, rigid sort of hierarchy of behavior and temple organization and so on. And he influenced many, many people. I know way back in, it must have been about 1994, well, it was before I was ordained in 94, so it must have been 92 or 93, a long time ago. My teacher, Tozen Akiyama, asked me to go to Japan to spend 2 weeks practicing at the Toyama Nisodo, which was a monastic setting training center for women. I did, and there were only a handful of women there, and the Roshi was quite wonderful. She was daunting, and I was, of course, terrified. I was a lay person. I didn't understand any Japanese, and she asked me about my name, and I had to turn my rakusho around to show it to her because I didn't know, you know. But anyway, at the same time, through my teacher, I had read the earlier translation of Homeless Kōdō, and I knew all about Sawaki Roshi. So she had a picture of him. I think she had been to one of his lectures or something. And I said, oh, Sawaki Roshi. Well, you know, she was thrilled, and I became quite a wonderful person to her because I knew who he was. I mean, he was, and I hope still is, a very important person. But I think that Shōhaku's work on Homeless Kōdō and this book are important because we know all about him, but we don't hear from him much. You know, we hear that he was this wonderful, tough guy, you know, who was a teacher. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else got anything? Anyone? Yes?
There was a sentence where what I caught was something like, the universe is without character.
The Buddha is without character, he said. I'll find it for you again, if I can. He basically said, let's see, it was toward the end.
Perhaps reality is without character.
Yeah, was the
yes, yes. I mean, ultimate reality, not the reality we're speaking in.
So it's a curious word for me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm wondering if the word characteristic, because when I think about the word character, I see characters as individuals in this world. Whereas characteristic would refer to qualities.
Well, actually, he uses the word, he says the Buddha is without character, meaning he has no characteristics. So if you're without character of any kind, there's nothing by which you can be defined.
Right.
So that's why, but you're right. You know, I speak of my character, your character. Yeah. We mean sort of who we are. And he basically says you can't say who the Buddha is.
Yeah.
You know, there we have no characteristics to hang on to. This is the thing that when we speak about ultimate reality, which we can't know it, because everything, if you will, is possibility without characteristics, as through the workings of impermanence and interdependence, you know, they come into being with characteristics taken from the flow, you know, is given to them. So one reason we can't know it is that for us there is nothing we can perceive. We always have to, you know, this has to be a table or I don't see it.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember having a conversation, again, a long time ago. I was at Hoshinji for a sesshin, and the abbot there, we had to, you know, go in and ask a question. It was terrifying. You had to go in, you know, and ask him something. But it was very interesting. I said to him one day, I think I understand a bit the nature of, you know, ultimate reality, and that everything is equal there. It's all possibility. And I said, but nothing can happen there. So nothing can react. Doesn't it have to come back here? And he smiled and said, yes, Satori and Mayoi are two sides of the same hand. In other words, the world we live in and the world of absolute equality, it's the same world because it's all working together. But it was funny because I thought, I've got it. Okay, there it is. Wait a minute. You know, nothing's going on there that I could perceive. But I think it's helpful to understand that we're equal in what we do because it what do we say, you know, it levels the field for everybody. There's a kind of metaphor that I use, and the people from the workshop will forgive me, I used it yesterday. The Fat San, who was a great Chinese teacher in the Huayan tradition, used examples to explain the relationship between a thing and the whole, and I ended up converting it mostly because I was teaching in prisons. I've forgotten his example, but let's say you have a barn, and in the barn there is a rafter, okay, big rafter. But Fatsang would say, the rafter is the barn, and you go, now wait a minute, no, it's not the barn. However, you take away the rafter, you have no barn. And if the rafter is lying on the ground, on the grass, it's just a long piece of wood. It's only a rafter in its function with the barn. The same is true of a teeny tiny little nail in that barn. You say, well, there's a big rafter and a little nail. Yet, the nail is part of the barn, and it derives its character, just if you will, as a nail, because it's plugged into the wood there. So, it's important to understand that there is no whole without parts, and to be a part is to be part of a whole. So it's always this lovely interlocking kind of thing.
Well, then that segues nicely into the other comment that I wanted mm-hmm. to bring up, which is about embracing
mm-hmm.
the universe. I was thinking about participation, the individual's participation mm-hmm. in mm-hmm. the universe. And fortunately, that came out in just a few lines after yeah. we were talking about embracing the universe. So it appears to me that when we are talking about embracing the universe, we're also referring to embracing our own participation yes. in this tremendous ongoing
yes.
flow.
Yeah. See, because if we can glimpse it or sense it, then we can begin to understand that we're part of it.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, they go together. You don't stand back and look at the universe.
Yes. Right. Yeah.
And that's always the problem, that to observe something, it has to be away from you so you can see it. I can see you because you're not right mm-hmm. here. Mm-hmm. But with the universe, we're in the middle of it. I like to say that it's like, you know, a corpuscle trying to perceive blood. It is blood, you know, and so we try to. So again, in a way, it's encouraging, I think, because it says, it used to scare me to death because we'd read things like, you know, I am the universe. But we really are, in the sense that like the rafter, like the nail, we're critical to it. Which means, again, everything has weight, has importance. The tough part of it is, I think, that means the universe includes wars and rape and murder. And, you know, Dogen said that we are Buddha nature. We don't have it. We are Buddha nature. Everything is Buddha nature. And then you think, well, wait a minute. You know, is what's happening in Syria Buddha nature? I think in a kind of objective sense, yes, it is. But what's happening there is a matter of human choice. All the other things in the universe do what they do by their nature. Our nature is to have choice. So when I think, oh, I am Buddha nature, I have to follow it with the question, what kind of Buddha nature do I want to be? I mean, the tree can't choose, but I can. So most of the evil in the world, if you will, is human produced. You can have a huge catastrophe, a tsunami, an earthquake, thousands of people die. It's a tragedy, but it's not evil. And people make that mistake. You know, it's the earth doing what the earth does. But war, we do, and we don't have to. You know, when the tectonic plates in the earth reach a certain place, you're going to have, you know, an earthquake must happen. We don't have to kill one another. So if I am Buddha nature, I'm stuck with the awful responsibility of deciding how I want that to be. And as you say, full participation. So it's exciting. You're also kind of stuck with it. I mean, it's anybody else? Yes.
Early on in your talk, you made this statement, I think, that we are explorers.
Mm-hmm.
I found that very, very thought-provoking, because Dogen's always talking about we need to investigate this and investigate that.
Yep.
I wonder if you could say a little bit more about that notion of exploration.
Well, first of all, you know, explorers hope to find out something, to learn something. So in that simple sense, to explore is to go beyond yourself. And hopefully we're all doing that. But it may not be a direct response, but she said, well, what came up in my mind was the realization I had that, you know, we speak of walking the path. Are we following a laid down road? We may be, in the sense of, you know, the footsteps of the ancestors. But actually, the path that is our life, we are creating as we move. And the degree to which we move exploring, you know, out into the world, our path has a certain nature. So that, you know, if you go off-road and you go into the woods and you don't have a map, or maybe you have a map, but now it doesn't look like the map, you are forging a way. And I think we forge a way. And again, to go back, you know, what kind of way depends on exactly how we do that. So to me, exploring is, it's also, I think, the breath of life, because as long as you have curiosity, there's always something new to know about. Assuming you don't want to know about it to possess it, but just to learn about, because the world is vast. So I don't know, is that helpful? Yes. Sure.
I would love to hear you talk about how Zazen relates to embracing and full participation.
Okay.
Particularly because we're so still. Mm-hmm. And when I think of participation, it usually involves movement, engagement, interaction, mm-hmm. and Zazen has a very different quality.
Well, if you notice, and of course being me, I can't quote a very famous quote because I don't have that kind of mind, but if you notice that Dogen says in Genjo Koan that, you know, going out to grasp the world mm-hmm. is a mistake, mm-hmm. and letting the world come to you and validate you is the way. So I think that to participate also means to allow everything to come in and be still, and that is, or it is, or what can happen in Zazen, because you're suddenly open and you're not trying to control anything. The problem with, in a way, you know, he says embrace it, and of course that implies grab onto it. But I think that the true thing, the complete picture would be to both reach for it and let it come to you. And that's what Zazen is. And it, for me anyway, it helps me, you know, when I get up from the cushion, there's the world again. But to, again, let it come to me a little more than I was maybe willing to before. So I don't, that's just a personal thing on Zazen. It's not the dogma or the doctrine necessarily. Anybody else? We all. I've stunned you into silence. We finished? Oh, yes.
So I was very glad that you spoke about some of the difficult things that mm-hmm. are happening in the world and the evil that yeah. people do. Because sometimes I feel that we make a virtue of accepting everything. And there's a lot going on, especially these days, that I feel I want to resist, that I should resist. And for example, rolling back environmental regulations. I have an idea that many of the Buddhist teachers we mm-hmm. study would think that that was a terrible sure. idea and a kind of violence mm-hmm. to other beings. And so I think I'm still having a problem, though, with the idea that in true reality, everything is equal. Mm-hmm. And that implies then that I would, if I could only see true reality, mm-hmm. I would accept it completely, mm-hmm. every aspect of it mm-hmm. Equally. Mm-hmm. But does that mean that I would accept violence mm-hmm. towards other beings mm-hmm. just as I would accept taking care of mm-hmm. other beings? So I'm having trouble
yeah.
here.
Yeah. Well, like, I think we all do, and I think it's something that many of us as Buddhists, you know, face particularly today, mm-hmm. everybody in this country. With the things that are happening. A couple of things. They say true reality. Mm-hmm. I would say one kind of reality.
Mm-hmm.
True implies that this is false, you know, I mean, but that in ultimate reality, or you give it kind of funny words, but in one way of viewing reality, mm-hmm. everything is equal because it participates in the process. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, but at the same time, I wouldn't call it true reality because this reality of relativity is also true in its own way. I mean, it's one thing.
Right, yeah.
But let me also talk about acceptance. I remember having actually a kind of a bursting out at my own teacher many years ago about accepting things. You're always like accepting things. And, you know, it's unacceptable.
Mm.
But then I realized that there are a couple of ways you can look at that word. Mm. To accept is to see it clearly. Accept mm-hmm. its true, its nature.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can decide whether you want to receive it mm-hmm. or reject it and fight against it.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, when it says, you know, accepting everything, it means don't pretend about it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't wish it away.
Mm-hmm.
See it for what it is. And then, having done that, you can decide whether to embrace it or to reject it.
Mm-hmm.
But because there's a kind of double understanding, one way of looking at the word acceptance is, well, it's fine. You know, mm-hmm. I accept it.
Right, right.
We get, I think, off the track a little bit as Buddhists because for me, you know, the Buddhist teaching says to try to see clearly
mm-hmm.
and don't pretend to yourself. It also means don't be swayed by the going attitude, which might be, sound wonderful, but if it's just everybody does it, you know, everybody mm-hmm. thinks that. But to really look at it and then accept as the reality of it, what you perceive, then you can decide
mm-hmm.
whether to write letters, march, you know, object,
mm-hmm.
if you feel that what's happening is damaging.
Mm-hmm.
So the word acceptance is a real trap, I think. I mean, a mistake that we make ourselves. Because, I mean, I remember saying, it is not acceptable. He kind of grinned at me, you know. But, and that's when I thought, wait a minute, what are we talking about here?
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying, yeah, but it's real.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, not you should love it to death, but you've got to see that it's, and it's with what's happening today, there it's easy to also put your head in the sand and say, oh, it won't really happen. And then you have to look and say, what is actually happening now?
Mm-hmm.
And do I accept it or do I, you know, do I welcome it or do I resist it?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. But I hear a lot of stuff on the internet, you know, discussions among teachers that I think is, they're caught in the same trap you're caught in, to be mm-hmm. honest with you.
Yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Thank you. What you said is very helpful.
So, could we conclude that accepting does not mean condoning?
Sure. Right. It just means you see it clearly. And you accept its reality.
Yeah.
But you don't condone it, no.
Yes.
You might, but you don't have to. And the difficulty is that we sometimes don't accept its reality.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, then we're in trouble.
Yeah.
We haven't seen it clearly. But, you know. Yes?
It seems to me another danger or difficulty with exception and so forth is in speech, at least in English, invariably you pull in this is not acceptable, which is really another way of saying I don't like it.
Sure.
Well, as soon as we get to there, well, we're in the same, you know, we're in that very basic problematic place.
I agree entirely.
Yeah.
I don't like it.
Yeah.
No, you're absolutely correct. It's a very helpful remark because, you know, if I use the words, it's not acceptable. To me, that's a problem because I don't like it. But if we say, you know, if we can remember, as I didn't when I had my conversation with my teacher, to say, but that's damaging. Or that's not beneficial, or that's harmful, and avoid the trap of, you know, I it's not acceptable to me, therefore it's bad. Well, that may not be true at all. It's just my ego talking. So thank you. That's very helpful, very helpful. Anybody? I think perhaps we have come to a conclusion here. Okay. Now, the chant first. Okay, sorry.
Four
at home.
Three times.
Yeah.